Hello everybody, welcome to round three of the 2022 Gran Turismo World Series. My name is Tom Brooks, alongside me Jimmy Broadbent here to guide you through the action, and we've got Manufacturers Cup racing here to come for you today. Now last time out it was Igor Fraga and Team Toyota who were on the top step of the rostrum. They were followed by Giorgio Mangano for Mazda and Killian Drumont for Subaru. Of course Drumont and Subaru were on the top step of the podium when we were at our World Series showdown. First event in 2.5 years in person in Austria at the end of July. And of course there is now a lot of pressure on these drivers. All the points are going to be critical as we edge ever closer to the world finals for the Gran Turismo World Series at the end of November in Monaco. Now don't forget, we are live in four different languages here for the coverage of round three for the Manufacturers Cup for the GT World Series. We're live in English, in Japanese, in Italian, and in Spanish as well. And we're very much looking forward to talking you through what is going to be happening on track today. Here is how the World Series points look coming into this event. Subaru leading the field by 3 points over Team Toyota, with AMG and Mazda tied for third, Jimmy.
Yeah, very strong showing from Subaru and Toyota so far. Fraga very quick for that Toyota team last time out. Can he get another win here today at Deep Forest Raceway? We've got a 16-lap race coming up with single-lap qualifying and racing medium and soft tyres being used in our lovely Group 3 cars.
Yeah, we do love this Deep Forest Raceway circuit. Back into the Gran Turismo foray in GT7 this year. Rolling start, as you can see, for our drivers, and a good opportunity for some slipstream moves, especially on that long run from 10 down to turn 14. And as you can see, they're racing medium and soft tyres. They've got to use both tyre compounds in this race as well. So strategy is going to be important to see what the drivers are going to do here in this one. And let's meet the drivers then, shall we, for this event. So Killian Drumont lines up with Subaru once again. Lucas Benelli for AMG. Rios Cockerman for Toyota. Giorgio Mangano for Mazda. Hafidi for Nissan. Romero for Genesis, Suzuki for Volkswagen, Inostroza for Porsche. Interestingly though, there, Jimmy, no Adam Tapai for Jaguar here for this one. And that's a shame because they were P5 last time.
Yeah, it is a shame, but unfortunately not able to race today. So Jaguar missing on the grid, of course, but very interested to see how the rest of our drivers get on. Especially Drumont in that Subaru, been very impressive this season.
Yeah, just bookending the driver's list, you've got BMW with Kasi, Caratta with Chevrolet, and Mosso with Mitsubishi. It is the win in the Manufacturers' Cup for Igor Fraga and Team Toyota.
So for the round two of the Manufacturers' Series, we had a very competitive car. Toyota was very fast there, so it was a place that we wanted to maximize our points. And Mazda could have followed us at the beginning, and I thought they were coming with the soft tires and try to really fight with us, but actually it didn't happen, and at the end we could put a little bit of the gap, and that was very important to add some points for the championship.
Drumont in third place for Subaru, another podium and World Series points.
Avec Subaru, c'était une course assez compliquée parce qu'on avait une voiture qui n'était pas très avantageuse dans les lignes droites. Du coup, on manquait un peu de vitesse de pointe. Et on reprenait tout dans les virages parce qu'elle a un super châssis, le meilleur de toutes les voitures. Donc non, c'était une course compliquée à la fois, mais on avait des avantages, donc en soi, on pouvait faire un résultat avec ce qu'on avait.
This season has been a roller coaster for Genesis because we started really high with the P2 on round one. But then on Salzburg, when I missed it because of COVID, we started to go back, and missing Salzburg was a big disappointment for the team. But I hope we can go back to the top for Monaco.
So then, welcome to Deep Forest Raceway for qualifying here ahead of our Manufacturers Cup event. We are on board with Mosso in the Mitsubishi for our first flying lap to get a look of this fictional Gran Turismo circuit. Big braking zone down into T1. Then, if you're familiar with the old Gran Turismo license test, up the hill in towards an S section through here. All that being very nice and smooth through here, it's quite easy to pick up the grass on either side, and this little rumble strip on the left that can really upset the car if you hit it in the wrong way. Then slow the car down, go underneath the bridge, and through this very, very difficult tightening right-hander, extremely easy to overdrive the car into this corner and end up in the barrier. On the left there, Mosso though does a good job of avoiding that. Now straight line as we go downhill towards probably the most memorable section of this course, this awesome stone wall on the right-hand side of the circuit. You drive the car towards it, don't hit it though, and then we go under the bridge into the tunnel. long straight through here. Great overtaking opportunity, great chance to slipstream as well. And we're coming up now to the biggest breaking point on the circuit. This is how the circuit sort of differs to how it used to exist back in the older Gran Turismo games. Big hairpin now, max speed, 260 km, hard on the anchors. Just try and roll the speed into the corner, nice and soft. And now it's flat out to the start-finish line. Also there, a little bit of wheel spin on exit as we come now down the hill. Gravity assists you with acceleration through here, and then this nice cambered left-hander just holds you into the left-hand side as we come across the start-finish line to complete a flying lap of Deep Forest Raceway. The time by Mosso there, a 1:24.0.
Nice lap there from Mosso, very tidy. What about Adriano Carrazza then for Chevrolet as he comes to break the beam to the timing line? Carrazza's had a good run of things so far in 2022. Can he manage to depose Mosso from the top of the order though as he comes across the line? No, he can't. He's some 0.7 back. What about Cassi in the BMW? He's now ready to come to the timing line. That BMW has been a bit off colour this year in the GT World Series. Can he manage to get the better of Carrazza? He can, only up into P2 though.
Yep, I would have liked to try and beat Mosso there. That Mitsubishi actually fairly quick at the gate so far. Here's a car that has been quick all season as well. The Porsche, handled by Angal Enestroza. He comes across the start-finish line. Can he go on provisional pole? He does not. Still behind Mosso there on the 24.1. Now we go to Shogo Suzuki in the VW Beetle. This Group 3 car, I think, a bit of a fan favourite. Well, it's one of mine, so that counts, right? And that's going to come across the start-finish line. What can he do in the VW? Goes top on a 23.8. Nice time there for Suzuki and VW, sorry.
So first driver into the 22s. Now the second group of drivers out on track then. So we split it into to two groups for this one. So the remaining five drivers ready to go out on the circuit and complete their lap times. What about Nicky Romero as he comes to the timing line then for Genesis? Of course, a new manufacturer for the GT World Series in 2022. As he comes to the timing line, is Romero going to upset the apple cart? He goes into P3 with a very low 1 minute 24. 1:24.1 there for him. Now it is Hafidi then, the British
Come
driver.
Come on, boy. Come on, mate.
No bias here from Jimmy Broadbent in the GTR as he comes to the timing line. What can Hafidi do? And he goes second.
Come on, lad. Come on, mate. Finally, a result that isn't last. Anyway, sorry, Giorgio Mangano in the RX Vision car, howling his way down the start-finish straight. Mangano impressive in the previous rounds as well. How's he going to do here? Goes in to fourth fastest. Very close there between second and fourth. Barely any time in it at all.
Yeah, they were second last time out with Mazda in round two of the GT World Series. So not a bad starting position for them. Fourth at best. What about Lucas Benelli for AMG? Goes second quickest into the 1:23s again. So lap times definitely getting quicker in these latter stages of the session. Now here's Cockerbin behind the wheel of the Toyota. Then they were quickest last time out. Of course, they won round two. Can Cockerbin go top? No, he can't. It's only P3 at the end of the session. Now Killian Drumont, we know the straight line speed of this Subaru isn't optimal. It favours the corners a little bit more, and as Killian Drumont comes to the line, is that going to compromise his time here in this session as he breaks the beam? And indeed it is. What a terrible lap there for Drumont down in P11.
Have to pay respect to Subaru. That's going to be a hard race to for Subaru and Drumont there. And here are the official standings. So it's Suzuki on pole for VW there on 23.8. Benelli just behind in the AMG of Kokobun in third. To feed him a boy in the Nissan. Yes, mate. P4. No one else matters.
Great lap from Mosso, the Brazilian driver, in P5 in the Mitsubishi. And Mangano, I think he'd be a bit disappointed with P6 because some work to do from the starting grid down there. Romero in 7th, Inestroza down in 8th place, Cassi, Carrazza, and then of course Killian Drumont some nearly 1 second off the pace. Whether that was a mistake or just the lack of straight line speed for that Subaru, I don't know, but either way, he's got it all to do.
Yeah, definitely. And watch out if you're ahead of Carrazza on the grid. We've seen how he likes to start these races recently. So, yeah, might be a bit of a bowling ball situation. Be careful that, guys.
Well, let's have a look then, shall we, as we get ready to go into this race. Don't forget, of course, you can get involved in the action here this weekend. GranHyperTurismo.com. You can get in touch on the social media channels at The Gran Turismo on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and on TikTok. You can vote for your Michelin driver of the day. And don't forget, of course, about the bonus campaign, which is currently live on Gran Turismo 7 right now. 2022 Gran Turismo World Series continues here for round three. It's the Manufacturers Cup at Deep Forest Raceway. The drivers are on the grid, and here is how they are going to line up ahead of this 16-lap race. Suzuki for Volkswagen is on pole position. A great lap time from him. He has got the Brazilian Lucas Benelli for Mercedes-AMG alongside. Cockerman spearheads row two in the Toyota Supra with the Frenchman Hafidi for company. Next row of the grid is Mosso. Great lap time in the Mitsubishi Lancer, one of the best we've seen from them so far this year. He's got Giorgio Mangino, P2 last time out, don't forget. Romero heads the next row of the grid for Genesis, and then Angel Estroza for Porsche down in eighth place on the grid. Then Cassie for BMW lines up P9. Completing the top 10 is Adriano Carrazza in the Chevy Corvette. And all on his own on the final row of the grid is the Frenchman Kylian Drumont. A lot of work for him to do. And here, Jimmy, is our first look at the tyres as well.
Yeah, interesting. I noticed that Kokeman has gone for the mediums. You tend to see the top four or five cars go for the quicker tyre, the soft tyre for a fast getaway. The idea being, of course, that you can then make a gap before pitting onto the medium, the slower compounder tyre. The strategy is inverted. If you go for the medium first, just try and hang out, try and stay on the soft runners as long as you can, then go for a fast finish.
Well, don't forget, of course, the tyre wear rate is at times six, so one lap is the equivalent to six. Those soft tyres will wear out significantly faster than the mediums, and we're keen to see how the strategy is going to play out over the course of this 16-lap race, as Suzuki leads the field then to the timing line. Of course, it is a rolling start, so the field a bit more spread out than it would be under a grid start. Should be a bit less dramatics into the first corner, but nonetheless, I'm sure once we get onto the long straight on that run, especially from turn 10 down to turn 14, we'll see some action as we go green and go racing for round three of the GT World Series in the Manufacturers Cup, as Suzuki leads the field down in towards that first corner into the hairpin bend, and he looks like he's run a little bit too hot into there, actually. Bit late on the brakes on the exit. Benelli closes up ever so slightly.
Yeah, really need to do that on the first lap. You're not really quite used to how quick you're carrying that car into the corner. You used to go a lot quicker through there. And just misjudging the braking slightly, it hasn't hurt him too much. Still ahead of Benelli comfortably going into this first section. We know Suzuki likes this sort of first section through here. Lots of very long, winding corners that seem to suit that VW at the moment. On board with Benelli there. Just having a little look around, seeing who's behind him in his mirrors. Kokeman already falling back as expected on that medium compounder tyre. And Hafidi, I tell you what, needs to get a bit of a shift on if he wants to stay with these front two.
Well, Cockerman's going to be a bit of a cork in the bottle here, isn't he, in these early stages. Let's see what happens as we come down this back straight then for the first time. Here's Giorgio Mangano, P6, he lined up on the grid. Hasn't made any forward progress in this race, but he's now right in the slipstream of Nicky Romero as we ride on board with the Italian then. So, pulls out of the slipstream in towards the hairpin bend. Side by side they come. And Nicky Romero versus Angel Estroza on the inside. And Estroza goes late on the brakes, but that's too late. And he makes contact there with Giorgio Mangano. And it costs them all time as they come on the exit of that corner.
Yeah, I think Mangano there just didn't. And no idea, about to get lunged by Estroza. I don't think that he meant to do it either. I think I heard him just say sorry there under his breath. But now he's pushing Romero down the straight. And here comes the Mazda on the inside. He's going to split the pair of them going down towards T1 and three wide then. Down towards T1 here at Deep Forest Raceway with Romero still on the inside. Estroza down to eighth place. Mangano still trying to make the outside work. It's a little bit of contact from the Porsche. The second bit of contact in as many corners. And they're still side by side coming to the hill, and finally Mangano has to slot back in to eighth place. But I'll be surprised if the stewards are going to allow that. A lot of contact there between the two drivers.
Well, quite incredible that the start of this lap ends up as it did in the end of it. Under investigation indeed is that incident between Mangano and Inestroza. Very late on the brakes it was from Inestroza as we ride on board here then with Nicky Romero threading the Ivory Needle. Let's have another look at it then. This is a challenge for position further up the order. This is Hafidi in the Nissan GTR going up the inside of Cockerman on the Supra, but running a little bit wide, however, has enough track position and enough momentum to continue and holds on to that place.
It sailed around the outside like the true nature of that car. Absolute boat. On board now of Carrazza, made up a place from the start. He's in P9 right now behind Mangano, Inestroza and Romero. Let's see what he does. He's going to try and lunge up the inside here of Mangano. No, decides against it. Actually, I think that he is there. Sorry, I think Mangano actually hit the back of Romero, slowed him up a little bit there, and then Carrazza made the best of it up into P8. Good move there from Carrazza.
Yeah, nice stuff there from Carrazza. He's had a bit of a confidence knock over the last couple of rounds with a few first lap incidents, so just getting himself very cleanly through will be helping his charge and his confidence. Here comes Nicky Romero then. Side by side he runs with Inostroza on the run down in towards the first corner later on the brakes. Nice and easy there for Romero, but a bit of contact there again from Inostroza. He's a bit quicker in that mid part of the corner too. And Mosso's out of shape here as well. He's going to lose out dramatically. Two places lost in the space of one corner. So Mosso clearly having had some kind of a problem on this one, because he's gone from being inside the top five down into ninth.
It might have been a half thing. We just caught the end of it being slow there. And Romero, nowhere to go. I think Mosso tried to get out of the way and actually ended up causing a little bit of contact there. So we'll see if we get a replay of that or not. But regardless, Mitsubishi now down to P9. Disappointing for them. Made a really strong qualifying for them. And definitely a team that's been struggling to beat up in the top half. Here's what happened. Oh, just gets it all sorts of wrong there. I think what happened, he maybe got caught out by the braking of Kokoman. Gets back up to speed. And then does he make a mistake here?
He's just trying to get out of the way, isn't he? Whereas everyone else is going quicker.
I don't know why he was so slow there. He had plenty of time to recover on the throttle there, but seemed to get off for some reason. Interesting.
Caratza having a half look on Angel Inostroza. Look at that lunge from Mangano down the inside. More contact. Look at this. Proper hip and shoulder stuff. And that's the second time in as many corners as we've seen contact going into that hairpin bend. So, well, there's a penalty being given there for Inostroza as well.
I mean, that wasn't his fault this time. I mean, That was Mangano, the missile, out of nowhere. And Romero just looking at his mirrors and laughing. It's just funny for him at this point.
So down the start finish straight we go. Mangano having another half look here on Inostroza. Oh, look at Inostroza there, really sideways. Mangano sees an opportunity up the inside. It's really scrappy in the lower half of this top 10. As we come through into the S-bends, then it's Caratza in front. Mangano versus Inostroza side by side. Inostroza does hold firm in the Porsche in P7 for the time being as we come through the next series of corners. But nose to tail action here. And this is the thing here, Jimmy, isn't it? When they're running in a group like this, you make one mistake, it doesn't only cost you time, you can lose two or three places.
Yeah, really easy to do that when they're running so close together. So you have to kind of measure the possibility of the overtake. Is it worth doing? Am I going to suffer from this? And Caratza, I tell you what, I've given him a bit of stick today, and I have in previous broadcasts, but he's driving a hell of a race so far, up to P6, and now chasing Romero in his Corvette.
Here's the race lead, ready to change hands. Lucas Benelli going side by side with Suzuki down in towards the hairpin bend. That's how you get a clean overtake done there, Giorgio. And they run a little bit deep on the exit. Bit of hip and shoulder from Benelli on the exit of the corner, but he does manage to get that position and gets into the race lead.
Things you do this, now Benelli's giving the draft to Suzuki behind, so it's going to be a sitting duck all the way down now towards T1. Suzuki is right tucked up under the rear wing of that AMG Mercedes coming now down towards the first corner. It is side by side, but the Mercedes yet just has the legs, I think, down the straight. We'll take the inside line. Can Benelli hold him there, though? Is Suzuki going to try the outside line? Can't quite do it. Bit of rubber out there, so onto the marble, slows him up, and Benelli keeps the pace for now, but it's still nose to tail.
No luck so far for Kilian Drumont further back as well. He started 11, he is still P11, and these guys run so close to one another as they come through these S-bends. Under the tunnel they go, and as we know, Suzuki is of course going to have the advantage of that hole being pushed in front of him, that slipstream from Lucas Benelli, as we get onto the straighter parts of the track. And the thing is, they need to be a bit careful, because the gap between these two and Hafidi has come down. It was over 2 seconds across the line. It's now down to 1.8, 1.6 at some points.
This is the one, mate. This is the one, I'm telling you. It's going to be anywhere. It's going to be here. Not that I'm fanboy, but yeah, you know, that is one of the downsides of fighting each other, is you do inherently lose time because you're not taking the optimum line around the circuit. So, again, something else to think about when you're having these fights. Will Suzuki go for a move here? He sort of has a half look, doesn't he? Sort of puts the car there, goes very wide, almost runs into the back of Benelli. He's going to try and get the switch back here, but doesn't quite manage it. Benelli gets a really good exit there in that AMG, and Suzuki's going to have to wait, I think, another lap to have another go.
Yeah, I think that's going to be the case, isn't it? But it doesn't look like the straight line speed of that Volkswagen is particularly that impressive when he's out on his own. Let's see whether he can try and invent something coming down this start finish straight. Lucas Benelli knows that, goes for that defensive line as he pulls out of the slipstream, then down in towards the first corner, side by side. We run Suzuki on the outside, Benelli on the inside. Can Suzuki hold it around the outside? Benelli tries to keep it firm, but this will be an audacious move from Suzuki. If he can make it stick, he runs onto the rumble strips on the outside of the corner. They still run side by side, coming through into these S-bends. This is fantastic racing, and Suzuki does make that move stick and gets into the race lead.
There was definitely a bit of contact there between Suzuki and Benelli, I think. Just wanted the same bit of tarmac, and Benelli pushed wide a little bit there by Suzuki. But a good effort there. He did well to keep Benelli so tight on the first corner.
gap between Hafidi and Benelli as well, down to 0.6 seconds as a result of their jostling. Look at him, he's right up close now, and he's going to be within slipstream range coming down this back straight.
Yeah, and historically that DTR's been pretty quick on the straight down a straight line. I'm not sure how it fits in the current BOP, and I'm sure there's people in the live chat right now telling me how wrong I am. I love you guys. But Benelli, yeah, you see now he's starting to look in his mirrors. He's aware that it's not just him and Suzuki anymore. Hafidi has made up that ground. So let's see where they are coming into the hairpin. There's Benelli. I can hear a GTR behind me, which is always disconcerting. You can see in his mirror there, that big boxy boy in the background. He's coming for you, Lucas, I'm telling you, mate.
Well, the top three all running, of course, on the soft compound of tyres, so I wonder what their strategy is going to be, and that indeed is the case, because Benelli and Hafidi come into the pits at the end of lap six. Almost sounds like I know what I'm talking about at some points here, JB.
Nah.
Thanks, mate. So Benelli and Hafidi into the pit lane, then they're going on to the medium compound of tyre. Just a reminder that all drivers must use each tyre compound in this race. That's the soft and the medium tyres that are available for them. Fuel shouldn't be too much of a concern in this one. So it's literally just tyres and then back out onto the circuit. So Benelli will emerge ahead of Mehdi Hafidi then. That just gives Suzuki a little bit of breathing room.
He's going to have to put in the lap of his life now, because those medium compound tyres they've all got onto are going to be a lot fresher than these softs are at this point in the race. So we call that an undercut. You see it very often in F1. And so watch out for Benelli and Hafidi. Watch where they emerge compared to Suzuki after his pit stop.
So then we're coming in towards the halfway stage of this race, still very, very close inside this battle for fourth position. Goes all the way back to Adriano Carrazza in seventh place, and they are just a complete train of cars here. Somehow Mangano is at the helm of it, considering that he has been getting his elbows out, I think it's fair to say. A couple of warnings being handed his way, and as we come on this run down the back straight, will we see any slipstream moves being made here then? So Mangano in front, Hole being pushed in front of him. Here is Mangano on Nicky Romero then. So third place changing hands here with the Italian going up the inside. Is Innistrosa going to try and follow him through there as well, as Romero's hustled out to the outside of the corner. Mangano is through, and Innistrosa did try to get into the action there, but wasn't quite close enough to do so.
Yeah, Mangano opened the door there, and Innistrosa tried to walk through it but was denied by Romero, and they're still extremely close going down the straight. They're all pretty much touching as Innistrosa tucks into the slipstream of Romero in the Genesis. Will he try and go through the middle here? He doesn't. Carrazza on the inside as well. He fancies a lunge at these guys. Carrazza on the inside biffs Innistrosa, and he's able to keep the pace for now is Angel Innistrosa, but again a little bit more contact. It is getting rabid in this midfield.
This is like an old kart race. Oh, Mangano's lost it. He goes off the track, he collects Innistrosa as well, and now the Italian is facing the wrong way, and that is his race undone. Well, it's been a bit scrappy up until this point, and it comes undone for him on lap 8 out of 16.
That ain't the line, Giorgio, mate. That ain't the way through there. So yeah, of course, collecting Innistrosa as well, and you could hear Angel being a little bit less than pleased there, but I mean, what would you expect? So meanwhile, our fight for the front has continued. Of course, Suzuki has pitted now, and here are your top three after pit stops. Now, interestingly, they're now coming onto the back of Kasi in the BMW, who's yet to stop. Now, he hasn't got to get out of the way, and he won't get out of the way. He's going to defend that place for all he's worth. So this could be really interesting for this overall fight for the win here.
Well, fresh medium tyres versus worn medium tyres will be an interesting kettle of fish. Benelli jinks out of the slipstream there on Suzuki. Elects to pop back in to his wheel tracks into that hairpin bend and decides not to go for that move. Hafidi keeping a very close watching brief. There is Giorgio Mangano, who'll be sick as a parrot after this one. Drummond comes into the pits from the medium to the soft compound of tyres. He's had a shocker of a manufacturer series race here so far. Subaru, I should say, rather, really off the boil here this weekend in this race. And as we come down the start finish straight, it's Suzuki, Kasi and Benelli three wide down to the first corner. Benelli tries to get two for the price of one. It's the supermarket deal for Lucas Benelli. Suzuki follows him through, as does Hafidi then as well. So Kasi, those medium tyres really not paying dividends for him. He loses three places in the space of one corner.
That was a proper lunge. Got a lot of time for one of those. Benelli from downtown overtakes Suzuki, and of course gets by Kasi as well. Kasi now behind our sort of our battle for the overall lead, so to speak. But it just goes to show how easy it is that traffic can get in the way and slow you down here. So you must be wondering what Hafidi's thinking all this. You know, he's on the back of these guys. He's got a good chance to win this one, as has Suzuki, as does Benelli. So it's going to be really, he plays the traffic right, and Hafidi there, all kinds of sideways off the exit. You can tell he's trying to get that gas down a little bit too quickly though.
You can see the tyre wear on the left-hand side of your screen on the tower graphic. No wonder Cassis stood no chance. He's got half the tyres left compared to the likes of Fafidi, Suzuki and Benelli in front, who are all on those fresher compound medium shod slicks as they go in towards that hairpin bend. So the leader then pits. Cockerman goes from the medium tyres onto the soft compound tyres. He's the first of the leading quintet, as it were, the top five drivers who come into the pits, and everybody else following exactly the same strategy. So it's a case of anything you can do, I'll do exactly the same.
So here we come then down the main straight. Havili has got the draft of Suzuki. You saw him sort of wait into the hairpin. Is he going to go for a move? I don't know. We're currently watching some pit stops, which are apparently more interesting. There it is. Goes for the lunge there on Suzuki and on the inside of Benelli as well. So again, going to both of them sideways on exit. I have to assume there was some sort of rubbing there, as there has been for pretty much this entire race between the drivers. And Benelli just keep second place there, almost taking the nose off Suzuki.
Well, they need to calm down a bit. We've still got six laps left of this race, and it's anybody's game at the moment. So the top three drivers have all got these medium carbon of tyres. Mangano, the only one who hasn't pitted out of the 11 who started. He's a bit out of the sequence as it stands, because of course we know he had that drama just a lap or so ago when he was facing the wrong way. But in this top three battle for position, it's anybody's guess as to who is going to be claiming the checkered flag in 5.5 laps time. At the moment, it is Mehdi Hifini, the Frenchman, who is leading the way. Lucas Benelli with the haunched shoulders driving position. He's got the slipstream though in that Mercedes AMG as he comes through the tunnel. He's got the inside line and pulls to it now. Hifini on the outside, Benelli with track position on the inside. Side by side they go on the brakes. Is Hifini going to get shuffled down, and is Suzuki going to try and follow him through there as well? Benelli goes through to the race lead. Hafidi's onto the curb on the outside here. Here comes Suzuki in the Volkswagen. They're going to flick it right, then flick it left. They run two by two as they come down the start finish straight. Suzuki's got the slipstream in front with Benelli here as well as they go across the timing line. So it's now Benelli from Suzuki from Hafidi, but you can guarantee they'll be trying to change that order as they come down towards the first corner. Benelli versus Suzuki side by side into turn one. Benelli with the inside line, Suzuki on the outside, Hafidi trying to join the party as the brake discs glow red. Absolutely brilliant racing inside these top three.
Yeah, just need to they need to calm it down a little bit. It's great to watch, don't get me wrong, but you get the impression it's going to be just a game of chess now. Who has the right positioning coming onto the final lap? And you don't want to be leading, really, I think, coming into the last hairpin. Well, you want to, onto the back straight there. You want to be in the draft behind, be able to make a move and then try and keep the place to the line. So Havili now in a good spot, but they need to think about this carefully. If they squabble a bit too much, they do have Cockburn approaching behind in the Toyota on the softer compound tyre, so they've got to be careful here.
And Cockburn in the last couple of sectors has already pulled out some 0.4 seconds. The gap now under 3 seconds, so I think Cockburn is going to get very much involved in this action. Nicky Romero some 5 or 6 seconds back from him. Here comes Hafidi in the slipstream then as they come out of the tunnel and into the dusk. Down in the inside, he tries to go on the brakes. Can he get that move done as he gets into the apex first? Side by side, he runs with Suzuki, and he does manage to get himself up to second very briefly, but Suzuki's got the overspeed, he's got track position and more traction on the exit of the corner, and now it's back into the slipstream for Hafidi as he comes to the timing line once more.
Might have to lift. He does have to lift there a little bit as Suzuki weaves a little bit in front of us. A little bit naughty there from Suzuki, but stewards probably won't mind it. Is he going to go for the inside? He does have another lunge on Suzuki. Look in the background though. In a minute you're going to see Cockburn come into frame. That's how much closer he has got since all this fight. He's been going to the grass. He goes Hafidi. We know he's been a little bit enthusiastic with that right foot there and just got sideways onto the grass and slow down that passing attempt.
Oh, very easy to make those mistakes, especially when you're in such a high-pressure environment. The gap now with Hafidi and Cockburn down to some 1.6 seconds. He's right within closing distance here. Could it be two wins for Toyota in two Manufacturers' Cup races? Well, he's very much in touching distance to close up onto the back of this top three, but he's only got some 3.5 laps in order to be able to get these moves done. The advantage for him is that he is on the soft compound of tyre. They are quicker. They do give more grip under braking, and a big wobble for Hafidi coming out of turn 10. That's going to bring him right into the clutches of Cockerman here, and he knows it there, does Mehdi Hifini. Nothing he's going to be able to do to try and fight that Toyota, and indeed the Japanese driver is now up through into the podium places for the first time.
Yeah, we are on our graphics here, we can see that he's absolutely burnt his rear tyres as well, as Hifini just sliding the car so much and just letting Cockerman go by. He knows he can't catch. I think his idea is just to try and stay with Cockerman, maybe get a bit of a draft, try and get back into this fight. But otherwise, I think the charge is halted there for Nissan.
further back, still pretty close between Mosso and Inostroza, some couple of tenths of a second separating those drivers. They won't be scoring any World Series points, coming into the final of the season in Monaco. However, it will still be a bit of pride at stake further down the order. Cockerman will be scoring some of those World Series points if he finishes in P3, only one, so he wants to get as many positions as he possibly can. The thing is, he's got enough time here to do so, as the headlights glow in the darkness then, as we race into the night at Deep Forest Raceway. Benelli versus Suzuki seems to have settled down ever so slightly. They're now sort of running as they should be, not squabbling amongst each other too much, a couple of tenths of a second separating them, but Cockerman getting ever closer, corner by corner, sector by sector.
It's going to be really, really difficult here for Benelli and Suzuki to hold off Cockerman. That Toyota, we know it's fast anyway, and right now he's on the better tyre, on the softer compounder tyre, and you have to wonder, is this a play by Cockerman? It's got darker here, the track's got cooler, the soft tyres are going to last that a little bit longer and be that a little bit fresher, so it seems maybe it's a bit of a masterstroke here as they come out of the tunnel, and you can see pretty much now full-blown night racing as we come down to the hairpin, and just like that we're onto the back of the VW of Suzuki in front. So now it's a three-way scrap again for the lead, but this time it's Cockerman there in the Toyota. I think he's got this one sewn up, Tom, if he can get by these two cars.
I tell you, the man who's really in trouble here is Lucas Benelli. The front-engined Mercedes AMG has really worn out its front tyres. They're on about 43% on the front. Compare that to 61 and 55 for Suzuki as they come in towards the hairpin. Ben Cockerman definitely within touching distance now. The brake discs and the rear lights glowing red as they come in towards that first corner. This is absolutely spectacular stuff here. It's Cockerman from his compatriots Suzuki then in front, with Benelli leading the field at the moment, and it's surely only a matter of time before Cockerman is going to be able to pounce. He's got the same amount of tyre life left compared to those in front of him, but he's got softer tyres. They offer more grip under braking, more grip mid-corner, more grip pretty much everywhere on this circuit, and he is definitely in the right place to pounce here.
Got to be careful though, because those tyres will start going off soon, and there are still a couple of laps left in this race, so it's not all decided as of yet. So it's Benelli, Suzuki, Cockerman, your top three at the moment. Hafidi's dropped off slightly there in fourth place. You can just see his headlights in the background there as you go through the tunnel. Will Cockerman have a go here at Suzuki? We're in the draft. Look at the overspeed in the Toyota here. Thank you very much. Up the inside goes Cockerman. There's nothing that Suzuki can do, but I think it even let him have it, to be honest. And there goes Cockerman up into second, and now his eyes firmly set on Benelli and the lead of this race.
Yeah, I think he's going to try that down in towards the first corner if he can use that draft coming out of here. This race is going from bad to worse for Nicky Romero. He picked up a penalty last time around, dropped him down to eighth place. He's just picked up another penalty. You can see that with the red dot flashing on the left-hand side of the tower graphic on your screen. So here comes Cockerman then. Benelli tries to go defensive, but I think it's all going to be in vain as they come down the start-finish straight to start the penultimate lap here. It's side-by-side with Cockerman, and he's already got the move done before the braking zone into the first corner. And Cockerman and Toyota lead the race for the second time in as many World Series events here.
This is going to be great for their championship here, of course, because Subaru are nowhere to be seen. Ninth place right now, and of course, with Toyota leading, so it'll be fantastic for them going into that world final at Monaco at the end of November. But the race is still not done. Still a lap and a half left, and those soft tyres in Cockerman's car are pretty much at their limit. So Benelli knows this, a little bit of a grimace on his face there. No, he makes a little bit of a mistake into the left-hander. Is this going to be it, or can Benelli strike back?
Well, let's see what happens as we come down this back straight then. A pensive look from Lucas Benelli as he checks his mirrors. He looks left, he looks right. He can see the glowing headlights of Suzuki's Volkswagen Beetle as they come through into the light, into the tunnel, and then emerge into the darkness before this heavy braking zone of the hairpin there. Don't think Suzuki's going to try and pounce at the moment. He goes late on the brakes. There does Lucas Benelli, and Suzuki is really ready to try and get involved in the action here. And I have to say, Suzuki, just looking at the graphic, just looking at the tyres that we can see here, he's got more front tyre and a little bit more rear tyre than Benelli in front too.
So yeah, coming out to the last lap of the race here at Deep Forest Raceway, your leader, Cockerman and Toyota, although being gained on down the straight by Benelli in the AMG, not quite close enough. Suzuki in the VW goes for the lunge up the inside. He's cut off viciously there by Benelli. There is contact between the two. That was a bit late for my liking there by Benelli coming over, but they're still squabbling over the place. Neither wants to give way, but Benelli does cut back in front of Suzuki. and there's still three quarters of a lap to go. Can Suzuki find his way by for P2?
The thing is, we know the straight line speed of that Volkswagen Beetle's not quite as quick as the Mercedes in front. Of course, Benelli's having that whole punch in the air in front of him by Cockerburn in the Supra as well. So Suzuki's going to have to get quite inventive here and hope he gets a really strong run. Coming out of turn 10, we're about to find out if Suzuki can elevate himself up into second here.
Here we go then, onto the back straight. It's all or nothing now. Suzuki right into the slipstream of Benelli. Benelli thinks over there to the right, tries to break the toe. Suzuki follows him now. And now we're going to see if the VW has the legs. It'll be a last minute lunge up the inside. Will he go for it now? Or will he wait for the front straight? Let's have a look. Benelli goes defensive right at the last moment. There comes back across and forces Suzuki wide. Suzuki goes for the cutback. Can he get it? No, he can't for now. But it's going to be a drag race to the line between Benelli and Suzuki.
What a race it has been, though, from Riott to Cockerburn. It's going to be two wins for Team Toyota in two races. Cockerburn takes the spoils here at the Deep Forest Raceway. It's going to be a drag to the line for second as well between Benelli and Suzuki, and Benelli takes it from the Volkswagen driver. Hafini comes home P4, and look at Inostroza versus Mosso for fifth to the line. Inostroza in the Porsche just getting the better of the Mitsubishi. Wow, a fantastic end to the race here in the Manufacturers Cup. Absolutely phenomenal. Cockerman taking the top honours. Toyota back on top once again. Here are the standings then. 3 points for Team Toyota to take into the World Finals, ahead of Benelli. 2 points for the Brazilian driver and 1 point for Suzuki in the Volkswagen. Hafini with a difficult end to that race. That mistake meaning he just missed out. Inostroza, Mosso, Carrazza, Nicky Romero also having a challenging end to the race with a couple of penalties. And Kilian Drumont, unfortunately, he never really got going in that one, did he? He'll be hoping for better fortune in the Nations Cup and hopefully in the World Finals. Mangano, well, of course, he was facing the wrong way at one point. The Italian driver for Mazda on the podium last time. Sadly, it's P10 for him here this time around. Eduardo Cassi in the BMW, completing the 11-driver strong field. Well then, let's head over to the podium, shall we, and celebrate our top three finishers. Well then, the top three podium finishers. What a great drive it was from Suzuki and Volkswagen. They finish in P3 in that race. Really held on as much as they could right to the very end. A great drive from Lucas Benelli as well. Very aggressive in the closing stages in the Mercedes AMG, but it's P2 at the checkered flag. The Brazilian driver very happy with that result, but you can't take anything away from Riott Cockerburn and Team Toyota. Two wins in two GT World Series races. They are on top once again here for round three. Well, a huge congratulations to our top three finishers. Let's head over then, shall we, now, and catch up with our winner, Riott Cockerburn. Cockerburn-san, what a fantastic race. How pleased are you with that result?
Hi. 正直、表彰台に入れればいいなという思いでしたので、 1位という結果はすごく嬉しく思います。
Well, it's great for you to be back representing Toyota because obviously you missed the first two rounds of the World Series, but how does it feel to contribute to their success?
はい、今年からトヨタで出場することになったので、貴重な一戦をトヨタに貢献することができてよかったです。
You started on the medium tires. The two guys ahead of you were on the soft tires, though. How confident were you on your strategy?
はい、正直ソフトとミディアムどちらでスタートするか非常に悩んだんですが、意外と前が争っていたおかげで自分のペースで落ち着いて走ることができたので、結果につながったのかなと思います。
And obviously it was a great battle at the end, but do you enjoy close racing like that?
はい、こうして離れている選手と熱いバトルが繰り広げられたので本当に楽しかったです。
Team Toyota are looking really strong this year. Are you looking forward to the World Finals in Monaco?
はい、ここまでいい結果でつなげられてきたので、ファイナルもこのポテンシャルを生かせるように頑張りたいと思います。
Riott Cockerburn and Team Toyota, huge congratulations, and we look forward to seeing you in Monaco.
はい、ありがとうございます。
Well, let's take a look, shall we, at the point standings after round three. Team Toyota leading the way, but tied on points by with Subaru for second as well. AMG and Mazda all within touching distance in third and fourth place, respectively. Well, that does bring an end to round three of the 2022 Gran Turismo World Series in the Manufacturers' Cup. And next time we will see you will be at the end of November for the World Finals in Monaco. From Jimmy Broadbent and myself, Tom Brooks, thank you so much for joining us this time around, and we'll see you when we crown our new world champions in Monaco.